All right, hi everyone. My name is Sharlene. I am the Quality Improvement Advisor at New Jersey Innovation Institute. This is approximately my fourth year working at the organization. It's been a great organization where I've mostly helped providers with reporting for PQRS in the past and other quality reporting programs. So now, Sangeeta, you can also introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Sangeeta. I've been with NJII for a year. I've started out as a coach. Starting out before MIPS and MACRA actually officially got launched, as you say. So a lot of providers didn't know what we were talking about when we initially approached them and, you know, went into their practices to do the assessment. And now I'm an educator collecting resources for the coaches and in whichever way we can help you with MIPS and MACRA.
Mm-hmm. So today's breakout session is going to be about MACRA, MIPS, you know, what is the difference between the two? What do I have to do for it? But it is only 20 minutes, and if any of you is knowledgeable on MIPS and MACRA, you know it's not a topic that can be covered in just 20 minutes. So just keep in mind that today's session is a brief overview. We want to introduce the program to anyone who's never heard of it before, maybe only briefly knows a little bit about it, and also tie in how TCM can relate to the quality payment program and the alignment between the two. So everyone should have two resources in front of them. It's two handouts that we'll be discussing. You can all refer to the spreadsheet right here as a first handout. So the quality payment program is the result of MACRA. So MACRA is actually a legislative law that was passed by the government. And because MACRA was passed, that means that the government is now moving from volume-based care, fee-for-service-based care, into value-based care, and also eventually population health management. So the reason that everything is being restructured is because currently the healthcare system, it's not sustainable the way that the reimbursement and all of the costs are being spread out. So I'm sure you guys have all heard a little bit about it, but essentially, because it's no longer sustainable, the government is trying to find a way to really fix this major problem in our healthcare system. So everyone here, we're all part of a healthcare team. Our goal at the end of the day is to make the patient healthy and happy. And while we're doing that, that's part of the triple aim. Part of it is to really decrease the cost, improve efficiency, and also improve value. So the premise of MIPS and MACRA is all of that. The difference between MACRA and MIPS, and you'll hear a lot of it interchangeably, MACRA is the law. So MIPS is the actual reporting program where you have to do yearly submissions in order for the government to be able to review your quality, look at your cost, the advancing care information, all of that. So we're going to go into a little bit of the background. What is MIPS? How does it impact my clinician specifically? So it impacts your Medicare reimbursements 2 years away from the performance period. So 2017 is actually the first year of MIPS. And what happens is that the 2017 year is your performance year. You actually go to report that data that you're collecting at the early first quarter of 2018. And then in 2019, your Medicare reimbursements will be affected by the type of quality or what your overall MIPS score is that you demonstrated in your 2018 first quarter reporting. So right now, this is the MIPS era. PQRS, meaningful use, value-based payment modifier, you can wipe that out of your mind, although don't completely forget it because there are certain components of those programs that are similar in the MIPS program. But now your PQRS penalties, your meaningful use penalties, your value-based care penalties, or I'm sorry, your value-based payment modifier penalties, all of that is going to be streamlined into this one program, MIPS. So MIPS is going to be the only program that will penalize you or give you an incentive or just give you your normal neutral reimbursement dependent on your quality reporting, EHR reporting, cost, and additional category that we'll review. So the eligibility, we have a checklist right here. I'm not sure if it'll show up nice on the recording, but this is information that your coach knows and then will also be distributed to you electronically. But this is essentially the eligibility checklist. So the difference is that for PQRS, for meaningful use, there was different eligibility. But now for the MIPS program, you're all going to base it off of this eligibility list. So as I'm reviewing this list, I want you to think about your eligible clinicians at your office, your physicians, your nurse practitioners, your PAs, your MAs, your CRNAs. They will all be affected. So you want to think about their specific scenario when I go through this checklist. So do I bill for $30,000 or less a year for Medicare Part B services? Do I provide care for 100 or fewer Medicare patients in 1 year? Is this my first year participating in Medicare, which means not your first year at the practice, but your first year being credentialed with Medicare overall? Am I part of an advanced alternative payment model? If you answered yes to any of these checklist questions, then you are not eligible for the MIPS program and the provider does not have to report because the provider will not be affected by the payment adjustments. So once again, it's $30,000 or less in Medicare, 100 or fewer Medicare patients, or if you're brand new to Medicare and this is your first year, then you don't have to report for MIPS. So if you don't report for MIPS, the main takeaway is that you will get a penalty, a payment deduction on your Medicare reimbursements in 2019. And it's 4% for 2019, but in 2020, it becomes 5%, and then 7%, and then 9%. So this is something that you don't want to miss out on because you're going to see that impact on your Medicare reimbursements. And I really liked how Dr. Messenger really brought out the idea that you need to involve your entire team. This is not something that you're just going to rely on your doctors to complete or just your office manager to report on. This entire program, it's brand new, so this is really the time to get your entire team at the office or whoever else is really involved. Whoever sees patients, whoever bills for the patient, all of them should be involved in this process because this will, what the requirements for this program may change your current workflow. It may change the responsibilities of certain people on your team. So like the way Dr. Messenger suggested, you really want to review everyone, take a look at everyone's role again on the team, the current team. And once you get a better understanding of what these requirements are for the reporting program, you may want to talk to your coach or just talk as a team overall, reassign the roles and see, you know, where are the strengths, how can we optimize the credentials per se, and really take advantage of this program. Because not only is this program going to help you, if you report successfully, avoid the penalty, but there's actually a lot of opportunity to get an incentive as well. So this is money out there that CMS wants to reward for providers that have good performance per se. So if you have good performance, you're doing all the right things according to their requirements and their standards, you can actually get some incentive back, and that's really nice. So actually, what's going to happen next is Sangeeta is going to go over this next handout here. She's going to talk about the breakdown of the four categories and how TCM will directly relate to the requirements of this new program.
Okay, so as you all know that we've been talking about MIPS, MACRA, it's also got quality payment programs. So when we go out into the provider's offices, they don't know what we're saying when we say QPP. So QPP is basically incorporated, the MIPS and MACRA is incorporated into the quality payment program. And what we've done for you is we've aligned, since today's topic was TCM, we've aligned what are your takeaways when you bill for TCM and how automatically certain requirements of the quality payment program get taken care of once you do the steps required for TCM. And TCM gives you the money which your practices are missing out on. Because when we went out into the practices to get the providers involved, we thought the best way was, you know, when they ask us, what's in it for me? So it's the money on the table that your practices are missing out on. So when you started billing for TCM, as you see, it's 60% of the quality requirement. Resource is your cost factor, which is not going to be considered in the first year. Your advancing care information, that's your meaningful use reporting, is 25%, and your clinical practice improvement, that's a new element in the program, which is 15%. So if you can effectively, you know, figure out a workflow within your practice, start billing for TCM, automatically it takes care of the two quality requirements in the quality payment program. And the first one is the medication reconciliation post-discharge, which is a must-do step for TCM. You can't bill for TCM if you don't do this. So you see how the two of them get aligned, and it's a high-priority measure. The second is the documentation of current medication in the medical record that's in your EMRs, which is, again, a must-do for TCM, as you must have heard the group you know, previous to us. And, of course, there are improvement activities. Now, for smaller practices, there are 20 points required for your improvement activities, and for the larger practices, you need 40 points, and that is provided in your MIPS checklist in, you know, the first document which Sharlene was talking about. And you see, if you've done care transition documentation, I know some of it seems a little repetitive, but this is how they've implemented it in the QPP. So care transition documentation, it gives you a medium weightage, which means 10 points. Care transition standard operational, and you know, below that we've documented what are the requirements to complete the step. And of course, as you see right at the end, it's participation in a TCPI. If you're a part of a practice transformation network, that means CMS believes that you're already on the path of, you know, implementing improvement activities within your practice with the assistance of your coach, which is a high medium weightage is given to it. So if it's a small practice and you're a part of PTN, you automatically get 20 points, which takes care of the 15% which are required for smaller practices. But of course, I would also like to add that just being a part of a PTN isn't good enough. You have to get involved with the improvement activities that your coach comes up with. We are here to provide you with all the educational material that you need, whatever assistance you need. The coach is right there guiding you. So you have to show progress. And the only way we are going to be figuring that out is when the coach comes back. Every 6 months, there is a reassessment of the practice. And every 6 months when the coach comes back, the score, if you remember the first time when they came in with the 22 or 27 questions, they scored your practice. And when they come back, that score moves, which also means that you move from one phase into the other, which automatically means that you are changing things within your practice, the way you're doing it, the way you're documenting, how you're taking care of your patients. All those are improvement activities. Improvement activities don't only mean, you know, related to your patients. It could even be the workflow within the practice, which inadvertently affects the patients. So being an active participant of the PTN is what is your takeaway from being a part of the PTN. Mm-hmm.
And also, do you have any pediatricians in the room or anyone that doesn't see like a high Medicare volume? We had a couple in the other session and they brought up a great point. One of the questions was that I don't bill for Medicare because I'm a pediatrician. So does that mean that I don't have to report for this program? How does this all impact me? So even though it will not impact your reimbursements because you don't bill for Medicare, it is still going to be important for you to understand the reasoning and what this all really means, because the premise of this is quality improvement, is to reduce the cost, increase efficiency, and although CMS only launched this specific program for your Medicare reimbursements, this doesn't mean that your commercial insurers or Medicaid or anyone else may not take interest in this as well. These are goals of the overall government, the goal of the healthcare department, WHO. All of these goals are aligned with the overall population and the healthcare. So even though you don't have to specifically report to this program if you're not eligible, you still should keep in mind that these four reporting components is essentially what CMS is looking at when they're going to break down whether or not the quality that you provide is of high quality, low quality, standard quality, whether or not you are assisting in reducing the overall cost. And the ultimate goal is to have a healthy, happy patient. So all of this, the quality tracking, the making sure that you're improving your workflows in the office. You don't have to think about it as just it only being applicable to Medicare, but you really should apply this entire methodology, your strategy, to your entire patient population. Because as they all mentioned in the other sessions, this is alignments with Triple Aim, the overall vision and the future of healthcare. So everyone here does have to play a part and really actively want to help healthcare achieve those aims by just demonstrating something simple like quality reporting to CMS. Any questions so far? Because I feel like it's just us talking. Any PTN staff have any good questions? You can take any questions.
So I just want to chime in that NJII is working with a lot of other improvement organizations within New Jersey. And we hold regular webinars. We have a lot of resources. Please reach out to your coaches. The coaches will encourage you to sign up for healthcare communities. That's within healthcare communities. We put in resources which can be used by practices. It is accessible. You have to just go in, register under Garden Practice Transformation, and you have access to a lot of resources which are out there. So please, anything that you need, it could be related to anything within the practice, get hold of your coaches. I know as providers, as office managers, you have limited time to search for resources. That's where the coaches come in. They will assist you. We will provide you with whatever your requirements are, but you have to own the workflow that needs to be done within the practice for improvement.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. I'm not sure if you made it, and you very well could have made it, and it kind of passed me, and I just didn't hear it. But I think one of the things that the providers need to know is that when it comes down to the payments and the reimbursements that come out down the line, that it's a zero-sum game in the sense that people who perform poorly are going to fund the people who are performing better than the national benchmarks. And so I don't know if that is a widely known point, but providers should be aware that just another reason for them to really excel.
Great. And yeah, you make a great point. So this MIPS program is budget neutral, which means that any penalties that the government receives or administers and then they get that money back, that money actually gets dispersed to all the high performers because CMS does want to reward you for all the hard work you're putting in. This isn't going to be something easy that you can learn and understand overnight. That's why we have coaches, our organization. We've been an organization that's been a qualified PQRS registry for 5 years. We actually started off with the Meaningful Use REC grant, and we were the leaders of our state. So we have the expertise and the knowledge to really help you get a good grasp of what this all is. We want you to use your coaches as your resource. Any questions you may have, your coaches can help you figure it out in one way or another. Our goal as an organization is not only to help you transform your practice, but become high-quality, value-based practices that really understand and can align with the overall government health goals. So really, please don't hesitate to ask any questions. There are no silly or dumb questions. This is something that's it's a brand new program. This is the transition year. So this is the year that we're all gonna be able to really figure out what's the best way to move forward. Nope, yep.
I just wanted to give an example of the impact on this. We have one physician who was an early adopter, and his payments went up $120,000 a year. So I think when the doctors hear there's going to be a 1% penalty or a 2% gain, they're not paying that much attention. But $120,000 is significant.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Your question?
Yeah, I was just wondering. A lot of this, even this TCM billing, so is CMS looking at the specialists should be doing their work and the primaries? So is there interaction? So say for, I'm with the GI practice.
Right.
So, referred patient, the doctor sees the patient in the hospital, discharged, he followed. So they're calling in. So then you are the same question that, the primary physician, if it's first come,
right.
First. So is the specialist to stay out of this and let the primary follow up and then, you know, maybe down the road again be sent to the specialist? Because I know one of the reports Geet brought us back where they assigned Medicare patients to your practice.
Right.
So our physician had seen a patient in the hospital, I think admitted, and they hadn't seen a primary before at all. So that patient was allotted to the GI.
Right.
And so he, but he only saw the, and the expense was like, I don't know, $100,000. So this patient was assigned to this GI physician, but this was the only visit that he had with, and it, so my question is, that sort of affects him negatively.
Right. And
so how is this, I think I asked this, so is specialists to stay away from primary, any kind of primary practice contact or?
Not necessarily in the sense that you're not, you shouldn't think about it in the way that you're competing with the primary care. No, because, and not saying just you, but in general, it's not that you're necessarily competing as a specialist in a primary care. This is all patient-centered. So you want to do what's best for the patient. Right. And it's all about care coordination. So we actually want to help you sync up with the patient's primary care provider and really, you know, figure out a way to share all that information and to make sure that the patient that needs the specific primary care service is going to follow up with their primary care to get that service.
Okay.
It's not necessarily saying that you should not overstep certain boundaries or not do certain things for the patient because you want to do what's best for the patient at the end of the day. But the whole point is to really communicate and have the and communicate with the primary,
with the primary care.
Have a network
this
of is a communication.
Single physician practice,
right?
And if that's 25 years old, so there's like we, it's the referral practice,
and
they have a very good coordination. So just that this documentation seems to complicate that rather than simplify it. That's what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, and I know we're out of time today, but that's a great question that you can follow up with your coach. But it just even more is to initiate and have that conversation with that primary care officer, you know, whatever other specialist that you're sharing patients with. But thank you, everyone, for your participation today. And definitely let us know if you have any questions.
Thank you.
Thanks.